You're focused on two engagements, actually parts of the same battle. These were the first engagements between U.S. ground forces and elements of the Iraqi Army's Republican Guard. The battle, codenamed Norfolk, and another engagement which has already become something of a classic, an engagement already being studied at Armor School, 73 Easting.
We only went approximately 20 kilometers into Iraq the first day. Initially, all we saw was miles of sand. The next day, though, we moved through masses of enemy soldiers who were just walking through the desert.
Captain H.R. McMaster led a cavalry troop that had been designated as the spearhead for the Hail Mary as U.S. forces crossed into Iraq. His job was to find the Republican Guard without engaging them, just to find them for the larger U.S. units that would follow.
The next morning, we got the word, you attack in 5 minutes to the 7-0 Easting. I said, man, this is the moment we've all waited. The troop was moving towards a village that was not apparent on any maps. In fact, we had no maps of the area. From the village, the Bradley received 23 millimeter fire and also some heavy machine gun fire from the area. The 3rd platoon leader reported it to me and said he was returning fire with his Bradleys. I ordered the 2 tank platoons to come up on either side of me, and I gave them the order to fire.
Fire 1 round 8 at my command.
What happened is the 9 tanks fired the high explosive rounds into the village. As soon as I give that order to Mike to cease fire, he comes back to me now with the report, enemy tanks to the left. And I said, Roger, tanks to the left. And just as I was saying that, we came over this ridge. My gunner said, tanks direct front. And I yelled, fire. The first enemy tank erupted into flames.
First, I ain't gonna lie, first I was finna panic. And I caught myself and said, no, don't panic, do your job. I loaded faster that time than I ever loaded before.
I was also calling on the troop net. I remember rather vividly one of the enemy crewmen leaping out of the tank as it exploded into flames, and he himself was on fire. 2 enemy tanks engaged my tank and missed at pretty close range.
At the same time that Captain McMaster and his men were engaged in what has been described as a classic cavalry charge, scouts from the 7th Cavalry moved north of McMaster's location trying to find the Republican Guard.
My crew, my vehicle, we were the first ones to run into the Republican Guard out of the squadron.
You know, I was all excited, you know, let's charge right in there. But when I actually heard rounds going off and heard people coming back over the radio telling about it, it was bad. I was scared. I was terrified. I was, you know, praying to God that everything was going to be all right.
My track was initially, it was shot by a BMP. And as we were evacuating the vehicle, it was hit again. I was up by the driver's hatch of the vehicle, extracting my driver from the vehicle. When there was a loud explosion, bright light, and next thing I know, I knew I was thrown about 20 feet from the vehicle. But then after we got into platoon leader's vehicle, we were shot again twice by a T-72 tank. And in which every member of my crew and the crew of that vehicle sustained some sort of injuries.
I'm monitoring the troops' radio. First of all, everything seems pretty positive. Next thing you know, all of a sudden the radio explodes with medic, 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 and it's screaming everywhere. I found Sergeant Gentry laying on the ground. I started doing CPR on him, but as you know, he didn't make it.
As we looked back, it was just a sea of burning vehicles. I mean, just incredible.
McMaster's cavalry troop had been forced into an engagement with the Republican Guard. When that fighting ended, McMaster's forces stayed in place, while Captain Taro's unit from the 1st Infantry moved through their lines to resume contact with the Iraqis.
I never been to war, so I didn't know what I'd to expect, but it was surreal. we could hear the some of the Iraqi soldiers come out, and they were crying. The Iraqi troops yelling, Allah, Allah, and watch them get on their knees crying in front of that tank. You can smell the flesh, and you just smell it. And the diesel and the gunpowder, that's what war was. To see, hear, and smell it. And come morning, everything just started turning peaceful. There was no more firing or anything. With the sun coming up, everything just sort of died out.
And then about 7:40 that morning, in fact, 7:43 that morning, we got the word, ceasefire, ceasefire.
This is one thing I never want to have to do again. It's not as easy as just drawing that arrow on that map. I never want to go back to that desert if I don't have to.